thank you so much. Welcome back once again to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I know, things look different. The buffering gag doesn't work if they can hear the audience.
It doesn't work. It's live. It does not work.
We're coming to you live, second annual, from Sketchfest 2012. Let's hear it for Sketchfest. Live in San Francisco, California, my birthplace. You heard me. Also, this room kind of a birthplace for me. I want to thank the fine folks at the Punchline Comedy Club here in San Francisco, celebrating their 30th anniversary this year. And it was, in fact, that many years ago that I started here on this stage. One of the stages around town, of course. There were only a few way back when. But this was the first and most important room for a comedian to headline. As we were in the dressing room beforehand, getting made up and whatnot, there were some photos from back then, and the walk down memory lane was tripping and falling. But holy crap, the history for me in this room is astounding. This originally was the dressing room for a big rock club next door called the Old Waldorf. Bill Graham owned the place. And they eventually turned this into a comedy club, but Bill Graham would hang out here all the time. He was one of the all-time great rock producers and legends for this city and if not the country. But to have him in the room on occasion meant the world to a lot of us. And he really is greatly missed by me every time I come back to the city. But this room was the world, honestly, to a stand-up comedian in San Francisco. And working my way from MC to middle act to headliner, ultimately in this room 30 years ago, was, you know, it really was the birthplace of my career. And I have not been back in this room for forever. I would come back, of course, the first, 5-10 years maybe after moving away in 1983 to Smell-A. There's a great thing in San Francisco, this long-standing, in your DNA tradition of hating Los Angeles. It's fantastic. And when I moved to Los Angeles, I thought it was reciprocal. I thought it was mutual. They don't even know we're here. They think everything north of Santa Barbara, the world drops off. They keep sending out ships. They don't come back. It's nice to know a joke I wrote 30 years ago still works.
Still works. Still works.
That's true. But yeah, so I had no idea, but it's true. So I would come back and do gigs here, and then eventually, you know, there were other venues around town and whatnot, but to be back on this stage, I can't tell you how amazing and cool and exciting and, yeah, also kind of creepy it all is for me. So there's a whole bunch of history there. The Sketchfest is a phenomenal thing here in the city, and it's been going on for a very long time. Our very own Sam Levine can tell you more about it, obviously, than I can. Sam, you and Sketchfest go back to what, 06?
Yeah, this is my seventh year at Sketchfest.
And so how has it evolved for you?
Well, they have figured out a way to cram more shows into every single day than is humanly possible. I myself have 3 shows today.
You certainly do.
Yeah.
You will leave us prematurely.
I might have to. Yeah, I might have to bow out just a few minutes.
Oh, no, you're bailing. Let's be clear.
I'm bailing.
You have to rush across town. No, it's not too far away.
No, it's relatively close.
Tell us what it is you're rushing to.
I'm rushing to the Wet Hot American Summer live scripted stage show.
Right.
I don't know how else to call it.
Well, that's a good name.
All right.
And then after that, we reteam for the Thrilling Adventure Hour.
The Thrilling Adventure Hour.
Tonight at 9 o'clock.
Tickets are still available, I think.
A live stage radio play, as if kind of back in the 40s,
yep.
but with Foley and everything, of course, done on a laptop instead of a... But that's pretty spectacular.
Yeah,
the cast
is
pretty exciting tonight.
Yeah, it's a very exciting show. And in fact, if you miss it here at Sketchfest, you can always catch it in Los Angeles at Largo the first Saturday of every month. ThrillingAdventureHour.com.
Nicely done, Sammy.
Thank you very much.
Tell us who the sponsor is today.
Today's sponsor, as is always our sponsor, the Work Juice Corporation.
The Work Juice Corporation.
and Patriot brand
show.
Cigarettes.
No, it's the wrong show.
They're good for your constitution.
Okay. We have no sponsor. That's the sad truth. I also want to give a huge thank you, not just to a couple of our own crew members, Josh Negrin and Dr. Kenny Chen, who are with us in the studio each and every week, but made the trip here as well, behind the scenes. But Revision 3 saved our ass, soup to nuts, in every possible way. And I just want to thank Ryan Vance, the head of the team, and Tom, and everyone who's working on the team. In fact, give them a nice round of applause, please. They really did make this all possible. Cameras, the whole infrastructure was built in a couple of hours here. Robert here and the staff at the Punchline did everything they could to accommodate, and we really are in such debt to these people.
Yeah.
I'm just going to start handing out 20s, I think, afterwards.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
I got some singles I got to get rid
of. And apparently free drinks, which I didn't realize was part of the deal. Just for that guy. Jamie could not be more thrilled, I think, to be back in the city.
I'm fine.
Okay, good.
I hate being on stage is the problem.
You really do.
I don't, yeah. I'm one of those. I write for pretty people.
Uh-huh.
Like, I don't, you know.
Which is why we put you on this show. Because we don't have it.
I don't, you know. I hate being seen.
Yeah.
I'm very uncomfortable.
Which brings me joy that I can't even describe. How uncomfortable you are right now is why I'm smiling.
I'm just going to laugh.
Yeah, right? We'll drink about it later. I mean, talk about it. So thank you very much for making the trip, because I know this is your least favorite
thing. No, I've been having a lot of fun because it's Sketchfest, you know, we know everybody. And we've been seeing a lot of good shows.
We saw
hanging out with pals. So
a crazy, funny stand-up show last night.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly good friends, it was called?
Pretty good friends.
It was,
Eugene Merman, Bobcat Goldthwait, Michael Showalter, John Hodgman, Paul F. Tompkins, Michael Ian Black.
Dana Gould.
Yeah, it was crazy lineup, ridiculous. I've not been to a comedy show just sitting in the audience in forever. Mm. And does anyone get a bronchial thing every winter that puts them on their ass? Let me hear it from my
bronchitis. Where are Judas? Come on.
Where are my bronchitis people? I think I have it for reals, because this year, starting Monday last, I got hit and was laid up and finally got back into adult clothing the night before we came here.
I can attest to this.
Yes, it was brutal. I thought I was okay to come to San Francisco for the show. Thank goodness it was raining crazy ass when we got here, because that was helpful. Running around in and out of the rain, so good.
So you need to be like me and grow up in a house of mold and mildew and eat
asbestos.
Expired food.
Yeah.
And then you're like, I have the immune system.
You really do.
I do.
It's uncanny. You will not die. I mean...
I had a can of expired soup.
I hate
the past 6 months.
It's true.
I did.
Yeah. Ptomaine poisoning for you.
I was starving, and I didn't want to go out.
Ptomaine poisoning for you, by the way, was just, I don't feel so good. That was as far as ptomaine poisoning got to. Yeah, I hate to phrase it this way, but you will, in fact, be queen of the roaches after World War III. It'll be you and just them. So we went to this comedy show, and after a fantastic meal, oh my.
Oh boy.
And I thought I was recovered until I laughed nonstop for a couple of hours, wheezing, terrible chest. Oh my God, when I got home to the hotel last night, I thought my chest was on fire. I mean, literally flames, It was one of those things that I didn't think this through. Why would I go to a 2-hour laughing hysterical show with a weak chest before I do the chat show?
Peer pressure.
It doesn't make any sense at all. Charlie Day. I'm still 3/4 of a man right now. I think I've worked my way through most of the things.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you both.
Put that one right on the tee.
Thank you both for that. So because we do the show live every Sunday at 3:00, if you ever want to tune in, just go to kevinpollockschatshow.com. We're also up on the Ustream, Kevin Pollak's chat show. 3 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. Do the math based on your time zone, what part of the world you may be tuning in from. We get emails from all, of course, from all over the world. I wanted to share one that came in from the Finland. This jerk. This son of a bitch.
Ask Kevin.
If I talk over it, it probably doesn't sound so good in the room, but I'll bet it went great into the TriCaster. Here we go. Yeah, I got it. I'm just flipping through. Normally I have pages. What the fuck happened to this?
So who came here from the farthest
Thank
away,
you.
Huh? So any Modesto in the house? Come on.
Jan Carlson. I've got it,
you
Sandy.
Got it?
Thank
right.
you.
All right.
Marie Ham, Finland. Anyone know whether that's in fact pronounced horribly? Jan Carlson from Marie Ham, Finland. Hi. Just want to say I really enjoy your show and always get it from iTunes. How do I do KPCS? This falls under.
Right.
We ask you if you want to tell us, write into contact at kevinpollockschatshow.com. How do you do the show? Do you listen at the gym? Do you... This person says, I always get it from iTunes. A quick question. I'm sort of a watch buff. Are you? And I wonder what kind of watch Kevin wears. I spotted a nice Bell and Ross on Ed O'Neill the other week. That'd be last week. If you feel like it, it could be a standard question to your guest. What watch are you wearing? How fucking dare you? You asshole. Where do you... We should have mic'd the audience.
Yeah.
Somebody went, aw. A regular tradition on the show for live audiences is me to thank my viewers, listeners who write in and to us and then tell them to go fuck themselves. Just so you know, the standard operating procedure. So a standard question to the guest, what watch are you wearing? Horrible idea. Let's start there. Bell and Ross, I noticed that too. Nice watch. I have been a nutty watch annoying guy for most of my life and fell into the terrible Panerai world. Bought online, not new. Not stupid, and a Jew. All right. Yeah, don't buy it new. No, it's pre-owned in a day. You know what I'm saying? So thank you, Finland, all of you, for telling us how you do the show from the iTunes. Ask Kevin.
Nope.
I think it's loaded up once and then...
That's it. Yeah. You get one shot.
You get one shot at it. This one from Tracy Austin, a regular. We love Tracy. Kevin, which interview that you have done would you like a second shot at? All of them. 137.
Yep.
Is this 138?
137.
Is it? 136. This one's going great.
137.
Yeah, right? Same guy asked for the free drinks, I think.
Yeah.
No. See? It's working out for everyone. I don't know that there's, you know, the thing is, doing the show, to me, really meant whatever the fuck happens, happens. And we have a big announcement that we've been talking about for a year.
Yeah.
But we finally launched on Hulu.com 2 days ago.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah.
For free.
Also for free, yeah. And but it's something that's been in the works for a year.
Yeah.
So if you've heard me talk about it 1,600 times ad nauseum, I apologize. But it's official now. And it's a huge thing for the show to reach yet another new audience via a whole new beautiful portal. And the whole generation, of course, of you know. Although I did get some shit from Canada saying, why don't you find a site that we can use? So...
You know, they've got a lot of nerve up there in Canada, okay?
Yeah. They get sick, they get treated for free, mm-hmm. and now they want internet too?
Yeah, they get new episodes of Degrassi like 6 months before I do. It's so not fair.
I think everyone has a complaint about Canada. Let's go around.
And what's with them being so damn nice? What are they trying to hide?
Nazis. Yes, it's true.
Don't care for it.
It is true. It's all true. My favorite thing about Canada is that it's the nicest people ever, and for the most part. And you know, over the years, you shoot movies or whatever up there, and just try to find an African American. That's all I'm asking. I had to go there. You know what I'm saying? I didn't really have a choice. I had to. Okay. So another thing we have people write in to the contact kevinpollockchatcher.com is the Larry King game. If you give us a Larry King game that we use on the show, I'll send you a damn T-shirt.
No.
No?
I'll send the T-shirt.
Ah. Well, that's what I meant. Jamie will package up a T-shirt. So give us your size, damn it. So we got that straight when you offer up one. We have a winner this week.
Really?
Yeah.
I'd love to hear it.
This winner, well, you got the Chad. Chad Denick, because that's a name. Of the Puyallup, Washington?
Sure.
Anywhere near correct? Anybody? Puyallup? Puyallup? These aren't rhetorical questions. Chad Denick from Washington is our winner. Yeah. Larry King game, who our guest, of course, will be asked to do at the end of the interview, as all guests are. She from Groundling should have no problem. It is improvised and it can go anywhere. It's a bad Larry King impression, rule number one. I don't want a good one. If I hear a good one, you're fired. Bad Larry King impression. And then it's Larry sharing too much about himself right before he goes to the phone. Mm-hmm. And if the name of the city when he goes to the phone is funny, it's helpful. Bad Larry King impression, too much information from Larry about himself. You can go back to prehistoric days, it doesn't matter. One of his many wives, doesn't matter, whatever you want to do. Try to stay away from his testicles and his anus, we've heard it. And then go to the phone in the name of the city, funny sounding. So this one offered up from Chad from Washington, who says, 2005, I filed a lawsuit against the Frito-Lay Corporation when my 15th wife died in a tragic flavor explosion. Hungry Horse Montana, come at me, bro. Yeah, that's why he got picked. I just want to have Larry King say, come at me, bro. That's why that's why Chad was chosen. But congratulations, Chad. Write us again, you son of a bitch, at contact@kevinpollockchatcher.com and tell us your shirt size if, in fact, you want Jamie to send you one. All right. I think I've dealt with business. I know I just such a panic because I forget things every time because I am my father. who was one of my greatest fans. You know, he, it's got to be 9 or 10 years since he passed, but he would come to my shows. I was born in the city, raised down in San Jose, moved back to the city when I was 21 or so to pursue stand-up full-time. And my dad would come to shows all the time. And I'm like, Dad, you saw me like a month ago. The act has not changed at all. He was just so proud. And I remember him being in the back of this room so many times. So forgive me, these memories are going to flood over me on occasion as I sit here. It's actually quite surreal. We have Jamie sending some questions live from the interwebs. We're going to introduce our guest now. This is very exciting for me. I've been a fan for a long, long time. Long time fan, first time caller. like so many of you, I was introduced to her, I think, first from a series of TV commercials. And I thought, well, this is unusual that they would get somebody this funny, this talented, you know. And I thought, oh, right. This is that step right before you become famous. When your agent says, you know, you really need to start in commercials. And you're new enough that you say, okay. And then you start doing commercials, and it's easy and fun. If there are these big national spots, which hers were, and campaigns, and this turns into crazy giant paychecks, and you go, why would I do anything else? This is the greatest gig in life. And of course, she couldn't be stopped there, and done so much television and movie work, and I want to get into this latest thing, which has brought her all kinds of sudden and explosive accolades and street cred as a great dramatic actress, which for a comedian, as she's been embraced all these years, has got to be a pretty exciting time in life. Please welcome Rachael E. Harris. Thank you.
Hello, guys. Hi.
Hi. Welcome.
Thank you. That was so lovely. It's like one of the nicest introductions I've ever had.
Well, listen, those other people don't care about you.
They don't.
No, I do.
Yeah, 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 you too. That was very nice.
Is this your first Sketch Fest? It can't be.
No.
Yeah.
I think this is probably my third Sketch Fest.
And the first time was when?
The first time I came up and we did a dramatic reading of, I'd been doing the show at the Upright Citizens Brigade.
Right.
And my friend Robin Shore wrote, which she didn't really write, she just put it together. We were doing dramatic readings of an episode of The Hills.
Genius.
And I was playing Heidi Montag. Right. And my friend Rob Hubel was playing Spencer.
Of course.
And then we had a rotating cast of like Rob Riggle, lots of people. Lots of people came in and did
so
it.
So the first time you came to Sketch Fest was to do one of those.
Yeah.
I love that you call it a dramatic reading of The Hills, which is in fact a drama.
Right.
That's pretty spectacular.
Maybe I misspoke.
No,
it's probably just a staged reading.
Yeah, no, it's a dramatic reading.
But we took it very seriously, and it was
exactly
fantastic.
Oh,
it's
man.
One of the best theatrical experiences I've had in my life.
Has to be, right. Yeah. And crazy for laughs. And then the second time you came for?
The second time I came for, I love that I'm totally spacing on why I came up the second time.
That's why we do our research.
I know.
To put it all on you.
I know.
Mm-hmm. You know what? You were here for that thing that wasn't that fun.
I came up for that thing that's
it was horrible.
It was horrible.
Yeah.
It was really horrible.
Quite the letdown.
I think I got up and, yeah. No, I can't really remember.
And this year you're involved in all sorts of things again, though.
Mm-hmm. I'm up here with the Beverly Winwood Actors Showcase. It's literally like a mock actors showcase.
Oh, God.
That is...
When is that?
It is... We're doing that tonight at 7:30 at the
fantastic.
Eureka Theater.
Right.
And then tomorrow at 3. And that's like a cast of like Michael Hitchcock, Jennifer Coolidge, Tim Bagley, Jordan Black, myself, Mindy Sterling, a bunch of people. And what it is, it's like, when in Los Angeles, when you're pursuing your acting career, a lot of times you'll do like scene study things, where you'll put up scenes for different casting agents and directors.
Right.
And it's a lot, you know, you're doing, you know, you're really kind of putting yourself out there and everybody's very nervous. And so what we did at the Groundlings, it was Tony Sepulveda's idea,
it was a casting.
Oh, he's a casting director.
He's
like vice president of casting at Warner Brothers, but he started in the Groundlings.
Oh, wow.
And so
he
loves it, and so he has all of us get together, and he'll put together scenes. Like Jennifer Coolidge is doing a monologue from Jaws.
I'll say.
And she does it as Mrs. Magnus, which is this crazy woman that gets up there. So it's all people that should not.
No.
Like we're all playing characters doing scenes and things that we have no bit, like the worst possible community theater actors doing things like I would be doing a scene from Anne Frank.
Genius.
Like playing Anne.
Sure.
And it's wrong on many levels, but really very satisfying.
Wrong.
So I'm doing that.
We're wrong and yet so right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you're doing something else too?
I'm doing a screenplay reading of tomorrow at 11 a.m. of a screenplay that Michael Showalter wrote with David Wayne and Paul Rudd and Ken Marino and all those crazy kids that Sam knows that he hangs out with. Yeah.
Where's that at, in case these folks want to
I am not sure.
You know what? Go to the damn calendar for Sketchfest. Don't be a dick and ask us.
Right. It's on the website. It's on the website.
On the website.
But this will be on tomorrow, so it'll be passed.
If you're watching us live and later on the iTunes, not important.
It's not going to
be.
Really, it's just for the crowd here
live.
You
missed it, basically.
Yeah.
You missed it,
you idiot.
Yeah. You missed it.
We're trying to help the live folks, too.
Yeah.
It is a bit surreal for us. To have the live audience and I, I, yeah, So let's start, if we may. I like to jump around a little.
Yeah.
I want to know, playing cello in college, I want to know the easiest thing to get around with. Because my, you know, my visual is, you know, you're your own roadie. You're
yeah.
It's a thing.
Right.
It's a person. Did it have a name, the cello?
Well, I didn't. Did I name my cello?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I didn't. I didn't. I just would call it the cello.
Uh-huh.
I have to pick up my cello.
Sure.
I actually didn't play in college.
Okay.
I played through high school.
All right.
But I did. But I started in grade school in the fourth grade. This was back in a time.
Yes.
When you went to public school.
Sure.
And they came in the third grade, and they would play each instrument for you, and they would say, which one would you like to study?
Can you imagine a time?
And I chose the cello, and I remember it was because it was
bigger than you.
It was bigger than me, and it had this very low,
yeah,
resonating thing that I was really drawn to, and it was very sort of sad and melancholy, but also just very soothing. But I remember thinking that as a kid, like, oh, it's so pretty, and...
Like a bull's heart.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's actually, you know, that's true. It's like...
Or a whale humming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very, 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 very calming. So, but then I got to take lessons, and they literally, like, I just remember them giving me a cello. This is in Columbus, Ohio. This is like in Worthington, Ohio.
Yeah, Worthington, just outside of Columbus.
Yeah.
I have that in your dossier.
Okay, good. Okay, good. But I remember them, like, just giving us the cello, and like, I don't
take it home.
Yep. And I had it for years, and but I did have to walk to school. Wow. I know.
Did it have wheels? What? How was this happening?
No, I carried it.
Like, no, you
I
literally. Didn't.
Yeah, I did. It had a. It was a soft case. It didn't have this.
It's a soft case, of course. What?
Yeah, no, it was a soft case, and I would just carry it. I didn't even think anything about it. Like, that's the thing. Like, I just was like, yeah, I got to carry. Yeah, I've got cello today.
Mm-hmm.
Cello lessons.
Sure.
And I was terrible. I never practiced unless I was doing like show tunes, unless it was like we were doing. Unless I was learning the stuff from like Carousel or something
and
like
bye
that.
Bye Bye Birdie.
Right, and I would sing as I played like the bass parts.
That's
you know what I mean? Like the cello parts.
Yes.
This is fascinating. You're welcome.
By the way, this show is minutia. That's all it is. I don't want flashy.
No.
I don't want funny.
Okay,
I want
good.
Minutia.
Well, you're not. Yeah.
But no, do go on. I want to hear about this rosin.
I did, but I mean, I did take
Jamie,
it very seriously.
Jamie, you had a little piano thing, right, that you were forced to play a little in when you were a kid?
In junior high, you had to pick an instrument. You had to play an instrument.
Yeah.
So then I chose the piano because I wanted to learn the theme from Frasier.
Thank you.
Oh,
and did you?
That
I
is
did,
my favorite
and I was
thing ever.
And I was really good at it because it was like real jazzy. It was fun, but I couldn't remember it for the life of me.
I just love that you were a kid when Frasier came out. Like, I'm like... For a second, I was thinking
she'll be 30 on Thursday. Let's hear it.
Oh my goodness! I was thinking clearly you mean Cheers.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
Okay, now a little test for the audience members live who insisted on applauding when I said how many folks have seen the show before. If in fact you have, here's the big test. Don't give it away. Thursday, Jamie's birthday. Where do you suppose she'll be celebrating that birthday? Anybody want to venture up a guess? Nice! Disneyland was offered up. We have genuine fans, Rick. I'm sorry,
I'm sorry
to test you. Well, I can't wait to get sued by those bastards someday. And Sammy, you had to play the...
I played the alto sax, and then I took a page out of Rachel's book. I played the upright bass.
Boom.
Taller than I was.
Very. Yeah. So was my cello.
Mm-hmm.
That's fantastic.
I also have you know that I
yes.
was also in the marching band, and I got to play all the percussion that required note reading. So you know, like the marimba or the xylophone, all those. But that was always great at Christmas time because you got to play the chimes. The chimes were so much fun because they're giant, and you would just bang on them with these mallets. That was so much fun.
Let's go to the video now, then. Now, if I may, I impart a couple seconds on my music choice.
Yeah, did you have to play an instrument?
Well, I'm older than everyone on the stage, so...
Lute?
In my day...
Fife.
I mean, how old are we talking?
Close.
All right.
Fire. What? Yeah, we were just discovering fire, and it was a choice.
My face dropped as if you were serious. I was like, what?
Fire. Yeah. No, I bowed out. I could not choose. There was, I remember, you know, that first time your stupid friends and you got together in a garage and tried to play instruments and thought you were whatever that group was of your time. And I played drums, but only on plastic, horrible, somebody's drum kit, not real. And then the moment the real drums came, it was over in 9 seconds. Yeah, but nothing's cool. And I always envied those, you know, I had friends who were forced to take piano lessons and now sit beautifully and I want to kill them.
My parents were always like, someday you'll thank me for this.
See, that's just it. And you do, right?
Yeah. No, I do. I tried to take piano. Piano's actually very hard. I could always do the right hand, but I couldn't do, I say that like that's some grand, like, guess what? Piano's hard.
In case you're wondering.
Yeah, but I could do the right hand, but I couldn't do the left hand. I could never.
Really, even with those giant fingers?
Yeah.
How did you not take right to the piano?
Can
you even hold a fork?
I know, no, they can't. They're just for show. They're not actually functional. I just use them for show. But yeah, no, I know, I do have small hands. But the, yeah.
Which I just was thinking piano would be.
Piano was, no, it wasn't really like a.
You have small hands too.
Yeah.
Your girls.
I was always amazed by, and I still am to this day, anyone who can sight read like piano sheet music. It's like,
right?
It's fascinating
yeah.
to me.
That
it's
seems like Spock.
You just look
shit.
At it and be like, and, you know, like know where
shit.
You're.
Yeah.
It seems like seventh layer of chess that Spock mm-hmm. plays.
Yeah, yeah.
People
yeah.
music.
Yeah.
So you couldn't wait to put the cello down and go off to college to study the, but it said music and theater. So mm-hmm. what other music were you studying in the school?
Well, I studied.
Music theater.
But I took, like, I sang. I took voice lessons and was in every choir imaginable.
Was the idea to do Broadway and do music theater,
yeah.
and that was the big goal?
Yeah, that was the original goal, was that I thought I would do. Well, it's interesting because I thought I wanted to do musical theater, but I also wanted to do drama. Like
sure.
When I moved to New York, I quickly realized that I was an actor. I was like a singer that moved kind of well.
Uh huh.
But I could not dance.
No.
And in college, like I had this really mean dance teacher in college, and she would hold like my stomach area, and she would be like, "No, walla walla." She wouldn't say no walla walla, and my friends in college, if they see this, they'll die because I would had like a sway back, and my stomach would sort of stick out, and I'd be like, that's just my body, and she would say hold in like it just is a terrible.
Could
dancer.
You help me on the definition of walla walla?
Well, I think walla walla is like when you're a dancer, if
stop
anyone
sticking
saw
your stomach out?
Right, yeah, stop sticking your stomach out. I was like, I am not trying to.
So this teacher was the opposite of rude.
Right. Yeah, she was. Yeah, they were tough. It was good. It was a really great actor training program, but it was. They didn't. They took it very seriously.
Right out of college, you went to New York?
I went to New York right after college. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I wanted to do drama and musical theater.
Right.
But I wasn't really thinking.
Started comedy. Auditioning.
You started auditioning.
Right away.
I started auditioning for cruise ships and things like that.
Of course.
Of course. Would get cut immediately because I'm a terrible dancer. You know, you have to be able to do like kicks and all that kind of thing. And, you know, it just was not.
It doesn't help to mention you get seasick easily.
Yes.
If I may.
I do, actually. That's very funny. I get motion sickness really bad.
So, of course, you were auditioning for cruise ships.
Yeah, even out to Catalina. Right.
Makes total sense.
But I was desperate. Like, that's the thing that I can't believe, like, back in the day, what you'd do for work.
Let's talk about that, actually, because some of the better horrible experiences come from that very thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what an actor is willing to, you know, the old adage is what and quit show business,
right.
Which relates to, I guess, the guy cleaning up the shit after the elephant.
The elephant shit.
The circus.
We tell jokes backwards here.
Why, yeah.
It's like Memento.
We are the Memento.
We're the
joke
Memento
telling.
Of yeah. joke tellers.
Why would you do it the other way? I'm confused.
I don't know.
Okay. So let's go down that lane, if you don't mind, a couple times.
Yeah.
I remember being on the stage as an MC, and Elaine Boozle was the headliner. And I remember.
I got a mixed response.
They got like a. Somebody went and somebody went.
Yeah. That was 100 years ago. So I'm on stage, and my act was horrible. I mean, I did impersonations was my real act, and then I tried to be funny as separate from that, but couldn't. So just horrible potty humor and nonsense, and shit jokes. And I remember getting off stage after I introduced the feature act. And she pulled me into the dressing room, which was just for the headliner. And I thought, oh, she wants to bring me up in show business. Thinks I'm ready. So I step into the dressing room, and she says, yeah. My fiancé and I had just come from maybe one of the finest meals I've had ever, San Francisco being so good for that, visiting from out of town. And just imagine how we felt when I walked through the door. As you were saying on stage, I just took the biggest shit of my life. So let's not open with that for the rest of the weekend. So
I think it's a fine joke.
Right? You know, what comedian didn't do the panic in the party restroom as the toilet overflows? I mean, that's a go-to.
Yeah.
Who doesn't want to hear that story? Right.
Everyone has that story.
Come on. It's
they just want to relate.
If Seinfeld did it, it'd be genius.
Genius.
I'm thinking, will this bowl go down? All right. So give me anyone that comes to the top in terms of, oh my God, I can't believe I'm doing this. But beyond auditioning, you actually have the gig.
Oh.
And it's...
I did, when I was living in New York, my first job was a reenactment of...
I love it already.
Mm-hmm, it was a reenactment on hard copy.
Yes!
On hard copy.
Yes!
Where they were doing this thing on Huntington Hartford. He was this big, wealthy billionaire, whatever, that was now living in New York, like in a halfway house, penniless. And so they were going back and doing, like, reliving his life. And I got a call, and they said, they're looking for Bridget. But P.S., I was, like, 90 pounds and blonde and really...
5 foot nothing.
Yeah. And they're, like, they're looking for these Bridget Bardot types to
come
down.
Of course, that's you.
So, but I'm from the Midwest, so I go down. I'm not, I show you, in my mock tee, like, because it's the early 90s. I've got like a mock turtleneck on.
Sure.
And jeans that are like up to my ribs.
You better believe it.
Which I'm wearing in the show tonight, which by the way, P.S. And they have me, I mean, I couldn't be less like they were looking for like model types, like cool, edgy, like Kate Moss model types. And I come in and I've got like a ponytail and I'm like, hi, okay, so, you know, where do I stand? And then I had to do a reenactment where I'm punching a girl, like we get into a girl fight.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all in black and white, slow motion.
Oh, God.
And then I had to sniff cocaine off of like a bar. Like first I had to cut it with a credit card. Yeah. And then you slowly see me going down, sniff it, and then come up. And it was like, it was amazing.
Yeah.
And this is the best part, called friends. Told them.
Of course!
Told them.
This is your television debut.
Guys, I'm going to be on hard copy.
It's called show business. Right. I'm in it.
Right. And the best part is that this might have been a clue that I needed to go into comedy, because when we were doing the reenactment, the girl fight, it made me laugh so hard that I was in a girl fight with this woman that I didn't know, and then that you can actually see me smiling. Because I'm laughing so hard, like in the video, like it's like
incredibly
I can't believe
intense
I'm doing it.
Drama, yeah. You're smiling.
Yeah, it's so dumb.
Again,
it's so...
let's go to the video. No, we have a clip of this. Let's show it. Let's. They're gonna run it on the. No, we don't.
I can't find it. If I got it, I would show it all over the place.
Please find it.
Yeah,
Jamie,
it's good.
I'm on it.
Please find
Jamie,
it.
Jamie, I love this.
Hard copy.
She just goes like,
yeah.
I'm on it.
That was my reenactment.
Nice.
But have you ever had like terrible auditions? Because I had one audition for a group of
countless
Asian businessmen. There was no one that spoke a lick of English. And
in the audition?
We walked in, and it was like a glass room, so I could see somebody in before me, and I didn't quite know what they were doing. I don't remember exactly. It was like a commercial audition. But they went in, and they hit play on like a boom box, and you stood there, and you just kind of looked at them like, okay. And then one of them goes like this, like, and I was like, so I just start dancing like this, and I have no idea what I'm doing. And they're like, go, go, go. And I'm like, okay. Okay, here we go. And then they're like, I'm like, all right, thank you.
Booked it.
No, and then I go out and I'm curious and I see the next person go in and the same thing happens to the next person. And the person standing there like, and they're like, and he's, I for sure, now I'm like, were we being punked or something like that? Was it like at first MTV or I don't know what?
It's like, fellas, call the escort service. Just get to it. Why must you torture people with this? Nobody knows what this means.
What's this?
Come on.
What's this?
Act it out. Be a little proactive. Don't.
It was so awesome. I was like, I remember thinking, this is going to be a great story as it was happening.
Well, you were right. So the hard copy was the television debut, but then there's a little, the first acting job says Sequest DSV.
Yeah.
93.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that a little bit.
That
a little more legitimate than a reenactment on hard copy.
A little bit. Yeah.
It's an acting audition. You get the job.
Mm-hmm.
Booked.
Well,
it.
No, actually, I didn't have to audition for
really?
This.
Really?
No, because I was a weekend. This is okay. I was a weekend nanny for Roy Scheider.
I believe we call that burying the lead.
Yeah.
Stop everything, and we're just going to talk about that.
There's a million things like that. There's a million things like that.
All right, let's go down the list.
Like, wow, we are burying the lead. No, but with Roy, I was hired. I was catering and in New York, you know, trying to. That was my day job.
Sure.
And this woman who it was a kid's birthday party, and she was a nanny, and she said, my employer's looking for another nanny. Would you be interested in interviewing for the job? And I said, sure. And I didn't know that it was for Roy Scheider.
Right.
So he lived at like 70th in Amsterdam and like at the penthouse of this apartment building or whatever. And I remember, or 74th or something like that. And I remember going up and meeting his wife, Brenda King. And they said, we need this weekend nanny. You're going to come out to the Hamptons.
Bummer.
Right? Take the jitney out, and you'll be with us all weekend, and you'll watch our son, Christian, and I got the job.
Oh,
and
children's nanny.
Yes.
I was somewhere away. I'm sorry. Go on.
Sorry. That's in McCovey's Cove right now.
Yeah.
What circa Roy Scheider are we talking about?
This would have been early 90s. This would have been...
So, Jamie, you know these dates?
It was right before Sequest DSB,
yes, before Sequest.
Which leads to how I got my first
Where
job.
Where are we with all that jazz? That was in...
That was in like the late 70s, early 80s.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It was 79, I think.
Yes.
So, he's crazy wild world famous.
Yep.
And is this the first level of that kind of fame that you're in proximity to?
Yeah.
Even as an employee?
Right, yes.
So now you're seeing that level of crazy famous
yes.
in their everyday life.
Right.
I don't want you to tell tales out of school.
No, but I think it's okay. I think like I it's okay. They
give us something.
Yeah, I will. Yeah, I will give you something good. Okay, so they were lovely. He was extraordinarily kind to me and lovely. Mm. And you know, he would ask me, you know, he knew that I was an actress. He would ask me how things were going, if I was taking class, blah, blah, blah. But he wouldn't really get into it too much. But you know, as I've gotten older, I realized he really did extend himself.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
He didn't have to say anything to me.
Yeah.
So, and his wife was always very kind. And they had a 2-year-old. He was 60 and had a 2-year-old. And his wife was in her early 40s, Brenda, and they were very nice. But the thing was that I think Brenda would be okay with me sharing is that it kind of goes back to what Sam was saying. Every day at 4 o'clock, they took a nap.
Sure.
And by them, I mean Roy and his wife. And I had to keep Christian away from them. You know, like they, I had to let them have their nap time.
Yeah.
And I just remember thinking, as a girl from the Midwest, who wasn't really a nanny, but I was like, I thought this was like a babysitting gig.
Sure.
Because I'd grown up in the Midwest with babysitting, and so we did that. And but they're sweet. There's two things that happened. Okay, so one time, they move out to. I move out to LA. I say I'm going out to pursue my acting career. Thank you so much for letting me be your weekend nanny. Blah blah blah. I go out, and then they call me and they say, we're doing the show called DSV. You know, Sequest DSV. We'll be out there in February. Would you be our weekend nanny when we move out to LA? And I said, of course, I'd love to. So they move out to LA. The one thing that I noticed when I start working for them in LA is that Roy gets up every morning and he does calisthenics.
Sure.
Like literally toe touches, like that thing where we. He and he would walk, and then he would lay out on the deck with a sun visor.
Oh my God.
This is after his facelift. Like he would have that silver sunlight, and he was tan.
That's devotion. Oh,
yeah. It was devotion.
Facelift?
I know.
Son of a bitch.
Sam, I'm sorry. Did I ruin it?
I thought that was all natural.
I know.
Heroes
I know,
fall
I know,
hard, Sam. We've had this discussion.
I kind of hate saying that because they're so nice, but
it's
in a weird
record.
Way, I loved it.
It's public record.
Okay.
Yeah,
I loved it. Okay, but then this is the other great thing that happened that is one of my favorite things with them is that they had several nannies, right? There was like, they had their full-time nanny Monday through Friday.
Sure.
And then I would show up Friday at 6 to Sunday at 6. And then...
Full-time nannies got to have a break.
Right. Yeah. So she would get her weekends off, but she had friends. Like other nannies would all hang out together. And they were like from... she was British and like her friend was Irish or whatever. Like, I don't know, it was just this great melting pot of nannies from different countries. So there was a lot of people in and out of that house. And so at one point, some money went missing.
Sure.
From Brenda's, his wife's purse. And I'll never forget, they sat me down in the living room. I did not know what was going on. He was like, but we need to speak to you. And this, I had just started taking classes at the Groundlings. And they said, we need to talk to you. And I said, okay. And he goes, somebody took some money out of Brenda's wallet. And it was over $200.
Holy crap.
And is there anything that you need to tell us?
Anything you want to confess?
Right. And I said, I remember thinking, the blood draining out of my face and thinking, oh, I'm over before I've even begun. Like, nanny of steals money. Like, I just was so freaked out. And I remember looking at him and saying, I don't know what happened to the money, but I assure you, I did not take it. And if I did, I would give it back, or whatever. I'm sure he saw that I was terrified, but it was great. It was great because he just looked at me and he just goes, I believe her. And I remember thinking, oh my God, you know, my
blood. Same smile as a reenactment?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. No, but he was so, that was really scary. I believe her. So that was my only, like, scary moment.
Really scary, though.
Really scary, because I thought, but then.
So from there to working on the show as an actress.
From there he said.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so from there he said, I know do you have your SAG card yet? And I said, no. And he's like, well, you're going to need a SAG card in order to work. And he's like, it's going to help you get an agent. So he said, what's going to happen is we're going to call you, the AD's going to call you, he's going to tell you that we need you as an extra. You're going to go down there as an extra. Then in the middle of a scene, we're going to stop, we're going to say we need a line. They're going to act like they're trying to figure out who they're going to give the line to. They're going to pick you. You're going to say the line. They're going to Taft Hartley you. And then...
He choreographed this entire thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's be clear.
I owe him.
For those who aren't familiar with this sort of activity, this doesn't happen.
Never.
No. I mean, it's one thing for Kevin Spacey to hit on extras standing in the line for food.
Right.
And they somehow end up being in the thing.
I was going to ask you to
Everybody starts
me.
Somewhere, Kevin.
Huh?
Everybody starts somewhere.
Everyone starts somewhere. But this is a whole... This is orchestrated...
Yeah.
This is fantastic.
It was amazing.
Wow.
He really did
believe you.
Yeah, he did. He did. Yeah, he really did. It was really exciting.
Yeah, my goodness. That's a leg up.
Yeah.
And you look at this opportunity and you say, well, I'm not going to let him down. The man's investing in me.
Right.
I need to springboard this immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And so you immediately walk across the street to Star Trek Voyager.
Right.
To show that you're going to, you know, Sequest was not a fluke.
It wasn't.
That you've got sci-fi fantasy written all over you.
All over me. It was a big, Yes, main right? goal, yes. I scream sci-fi.
Sure, please.
Look at me.
With those hands?
Yeah.
But while you're at the Groundlings doing right. the live thing on stage, had right. you done any of that improv in New York?
No, I didn't do any improv in New York. I mean, I tell you, I wanted to
because
be
the Groundlings
Nightmother.
Changed your life more than
it
anything.
Did. It did. That yeah, that definitely did. Like when I saw a show there, it literally was like, I was just obsessed, and I thought, I have to do this.
Yeah.
I want to do this so badly, I can't take it.
And if anything celebrates Sketchfest, the auspices in which we're here this trip, it is the world of sketch comedy. And the Groundlings, we've had many people on the show that came from that school, but the sense I would love to know for you is, like, who were the big hitters when you arrived? What was the evolution like? And
yeah, well, the first show that I saw was at the Groundlings in Los Angeles at their theater, and it was Will Ferrell,
sure.
Chris Parnell, Chris Kattan, Sherry O'Terry.
Oh, boy. Horrible.
Horrible people. I saw that Sherry was doing the lady screaming out of the, you know, hey, get off my yard, you know, that lady, hey, get your ball off my yard. And then Will Ferrell and Chris Kattan did this hilarious scene where they're both two priests, they're playing chess, and then Chris Kattan decides to put on some music, and it's this insanely erotic, like, I'm gonna fuck you now music. And they just keep looking at each other going, it's a really good beat. It's got a really good beat. And that was it. And I was like, I need to do this now.
Yeah.
Right now.
And yeah. Was it a difficult audition process? Or?
Well, it's funny. Tony Sepulveda, oddly enough, they come in, they have just their sort of like anybody can audition.
Right.
And you audition to get into classes. And what I kind of love about the Groundlings is that you all start in the mailroom. You know, and you all have to work your way up. Nobody auditions into the main company. You know, you all have to take classes. So you're kind of all on the same page, and your writing is from the same point of view. So it takes a long time. It's very grueling. But for me, I found it extremely rewarding. And it gave me a family of people to be friends with. Like, my best friends are, you know, from the Groundlings to this day.
How long before you're on stage doing those sketches yourself?
Well, I started taking class. It was around 97,
right.
98 that I started doing. I was in the Sunday company with Maya Rudolph and Cheryl Hines and Jim Rash and Nat Faxon, who both just wrote The Descendants with Alexander Payne, Melissa McCarthy, Will Forte, just a great group of people that I got to learn from and steal from and
yeah,
and had such a great time with them.
And the first sort of success, as we mentioned at the top of the introduction, not too shortly thereafter, was these commercial campaigns.
Yeah.
Where you kind of took over for a little while there. You were one of the main go-to, if you want a sort of hilarious, charming hostess of your ad campaign.
Yeah.
Because you had there were several seemed to be going at the same time.
Yeah. That was that great thing that when, do you remember Danny Goldman?
Sure.
Danny Goldman was the first casting director that ever called me in, that ever gave me a call back. I'll never forget it, because he was very encouraging, and he said, you know, all it takes is one.
Right.
One casting director to like you. One person.
One
you
fan, know. Just make sure it's the right one. And
right.
Yes.
And so I believed him, I got two national commercials on the same day.
Jesus.
But that was after, and it's in my bio, and it sounds so lame, but it's true. It was after like 3-4 years of auditioning for commercials that I would be put on a veil, you know, I would get called back, and then, which doesn't sound like a lot of time, but it was
it's a lot of time to
show up. And
it's 3 years of, doesn't it just feel after a while that what they're really saying and isn't no, what they're saying is, anyone but you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or you get
that's
that thing
like
where you
me.
Start. But it was really good for me because I remember, and going through the Groundlings was really good at that same time because it made me realize, I can't do what they want me to do.
Right.
I have to do what I think is right.
That's it. At some point, you have to do that.
Right. And it became more about.
It takes forever, right?
Right. And it also became about treating those commercial auditions as if I was auditioning for David Mamet.
Yes.
You know, like for a play. And people hate to hear that, but I was like, that for me, that was kind of my way in. Like, for some people, they get on a television show right away or whatever, but it was like, I always heard Steve Martin say, be so good they can't ignore you.
Yep.
And it was like, whether it's in a play, you know, on a commercial, so I just kept thinking that, like, well, I'm not gonna judge what it is that I'm working on, I'm just gonna work. And I'm just gonna try to do the best that I can. And then I think it was the same directors that kept hiring me for things over and over again, which was so great. Like Kinga Usher was this director that would just kept using me over and over again. And yeah, in commercials.
Well,
and
that happened again in your film career as well, because I know you've done three of these Christopher Guest movies.
Yeah.
Best in Show, Mighty Wind, and For Your Consideration. Mm-hmm. And here's a guy who loves improvisers, of course, but is very picky and very peculiar in terms of the people he puts together.
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about working with the same director over and over again.
Yeah.
And developing that kind of relationship.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Chris has been on the show and has a certain reputation as being, you'll never know or rarely know that he loves what you're doing.
Right.
So what was your...
Well, my experience with Chris was that, again, everything goes back to the Groundlings. Mm-hmm. Like, that was such a... I was doing a Groundlings show. I was in the Sunday company. I wasn't in the main company yet, nothing. He, Eugene, and Karen Murphy, their executive producer, came to the show. Thank God I did not know they were there, because I would have completely just lost it. But
are you one of those performers, as a ritual, you don't want to know.
I don't
want to
know. I don't want to know who's there.
It's a long-standing thing. Some performers want to know ahead of time. Some performers, you cannot tell me.
I just want to make. Everyone's equal. You know, it's like, and that's sad that, like, if you know somebody that you're trying, like, I'm a people pleaser. So if I know that Christopher Guest is in the audience, I'm gonna win. Make him like me, which is tough. So
desperation stinks.
And really attractive. So So luckily he saw the show, and then I got a call the next day. They said this from Dog Show Productions. Chris and Eugene would like to meet you. And I thought it was another Groundling pranking me.
Oh God.
Because we'd all heard that they were there, and I said basically, like, fuck off, who is this?
What?
And they said, yep. And they said, nope, this is really blah 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 from Dog Show Productions. And I said, I am very sorry that I just told you to fuck. I mean, I remember clearly saying
that. That's fantastic.
Then I went in and I had a meeting with them, and they sat at two desks. Chris was here and Eugene was there, and we talked about a lot of things. And I had a crazy manager at the time that said, you know, when you go in and they're having this meeting with you, make sure, you know, you break into some characters.
Oh, God. Could you imagine if you had?
No. Oh, my God. But I remember in the back of my head, like, they would be, like, they started doing bits, and I was like, is this where should I break into, like, my lady that talks from the side of her mouth like this? You know, or, but it was so, I mean, I felt like Albert Brooks in Broadcast News.
Yeah.
Sweating.
Yeah.
Sweating, pit sweat, just so scared. And then Chris said, where did you go to college? And I said, Otterbein College. And he said, well, sing the, he goes, do they have a school song? And I said, yes. And he goes, well, can you sing it for me? And it was one of those things where I thought, is he serious? Is this a test?
Yeah.
Am I supposed to do it? And I sang it. And I sang it, and I was so tentative and weird, I thought for sure. I left that meeting and cried my eyes out, because I thought for sure they weren't gonna.
You blew a huge opportunity.
Right. Right, and I didn't.
And how shortly thereafter did you get the phone call saying the opposite?
Shortly thereafter, which I was stunned. But they were great. But the thing about Chris is that, which I learned after doing the first movie, because like I told you before in the green room, after we did the first movie, I thought the way Chris is that he believes if he hires you, you know what you're doing. And he wants to get out of the way.
Right.
And he's just like, go do what you do. But if you are so used to being micromanaged by different directors, like saying, you know, they're so afraid that they're not going to get what they want out of you, that they overdirect you or whatever, it's really scary when somebody just sits there and
waits,
looks at you. And you're like,
what am I supposed to do?
Right.
Tell me what to do, you son of a bitch.
Right. So then luckily, so we get through it and it's fine. And he is very sweet. And but P.S., I'm in love with him.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, who's not in love with Christopher Guest?
Yeah.
From Spinal Tap and Princess Bride and all these things. So I was losing my mind because I was just crazy about him. And then finally, Michael Hitchcock, I say to Mike, I'm like, I have this feeling. I feel like Chris doesn't like me or that I'm so annoying to him. And Mike said, no, he's that way with everyone.
Yeah.
And he said, you cannot take it personally. He's incredibly shy.
Right.
And if once he hires you, you know, he's like, it was really great because then I just sort of didn't make it about me. You know, it wasn't about me. Right. And
let go of the he hates me, he hates me.
Yeah.
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 It's crucial.
But I'm so grateful that I had that experience with him because it taught me a lot that no matter who I work with, I have to be okay with what I'm doing.
Once again, just do the best that you know how to do.
Right. Yeah.
Own it.
But it's really scary
because,
you know, you have to be, and that was the other thing about the Groundlings was learning to be okay with, wow, that really sucked.
Yes.
You know, like doing a take or doing an improv and going, this is so bad. Okay, great. And learning to love that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the larger scale of you learn more from failure than success so applies in the specifics of performing, especially when getting laughs. I mean, the audience is immediate to tell you, you know what, not that funny.
Yeah.
And then if you get the rhythm right of the thing,
yeah,
you get that thing that just happened.
Yeah.
You know, and
what
and
happened?
It. But it takes a while to be comfortable enough to let it land.
And that's what I think was so great about the Groundlings too, is like getting comfortable with like the silence and going, huh. And then it got to the point where then I start to laugh.
Yeah.
Like when it would tank so badly on stage
that
I would love it.
Yeah.
That's when it's really fun though too, because that's when you become fearless, because you're like, oh, fuck it. It doesn't matter. It's not going to kill me if they don't laugh.
It becomes a drug.
Right.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, how can I work it?
Yeah.
And it's really...
Will I bomb tonight?
Yeah. Yes. Oh.
So when they call to say, let's do this again.
Yeah.
The second time around, Mighty Wind, I guess, was the second one?
Mighty Wind, yeah. I did a scene with Bob Balaband. Where
he was lovely and incredibly talented.
Yeah, I just was so happy to be anything.
Yeah.
I just wanted to do anything in Chris's movies. I remember seeing, I was at the Beverly Center on a screen about the size as this monitor.
So small, ridiculous.
Right, at the Beverly Center
in Los
Angeles. The
first plasma was designed on that screen.
Yes. I remember seeing Waiting for Guffman at that theater with a friend and saying, I remember praying, all right, who cares, I'm going to say it, I'm going to do it, thinking, oh my God, if I get to work with one director in my lifetime, please make it Christopher Guest.
Oh my goodness.
And then like
a year and I didn't believe
later.
In God until this moment. I thought the whole thing was horseshit.
I don't know what it is. I just know that I prayed at something.
You said the
I don't
words.
Know exactly what it is.
You
I
said
know,
the words and they happened.
But God, it
forget
could be
the million
a woman.
People a day
it could
that are starving
dog.
To death. It,
it
doesn't matter.
It could be
matter.
A dog. It could be a tree.
Right?
It could be Nate, you know, whatever it is. I don't know.
Can I give you my little...
please.
What happened on that same screen, Beverly Center?
Yes.
The smallest one ever?
Yes.
Just the worst mall theater chain possible. And the screen is literally 12 by 4.
Yeah.
And Battlefield Earth?
Battlefield Earth.
Yeah. So Christopher McQuarrie, who was the punk who won the Oscar for writing The Usual Suspects, and I go for ironic purposes. We want to see this horribly shitty movie and laugh about how bad it is.
Right.
So we're there. It's a private screening. Nobody else is there, really. I mean, it was open to the public, but... And it's not enjoyably horrible. It's just horrible.
Yes.
There's no place to even have fun with it, and you're just, oh, now it's jury duty. And then it becomes a prison sentence, and then... So we're just getting barely through it by saying that, right? This will end eventually, right? You know, those kind of things. Mm-hmm. And then it got to the final maybe 90 seconds of the movie, and then... Yeah. As badly as we wanted this horrible thing to end.
You're like, no!
We felt somehow ripped off that we didn't get to see the last 47 seconds
That's awesome.
Of one of the worst train wrecks in cinematic history. You fuckers. Yeah.
Did you ever go back? Did you get? Have you ever
talked
seen
about it? Great on paper.
We gotta get that.
And then we talked ourselves through it and said, but we've never seen the movie again. Yeah, couldn't do it.
No.
Yeah.
You could probably get it on DVR right now, Netflix.
You could probably YouTube the last 47 seconds of that film. Sammy, you're almost out of here. You've got 10 minutes and then I want you gone.
I really...
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
You've got a thing.
I'm sorry. Show business.
I want to offer you...
I like that Sammy is spelled with... that Sam is S-A-M-M.
He's got a lovely story about it.
Really?
Yep.
I do not.
No?
There's nothing lovely about it.
And I think I said earlier that I think that you are dressed very nicely.
Well,
you look
thank
very
you very
nice
much.
In your suit.
You know, I like to impress people. They say dress for the job you want, but they were all out of astronaut suits.
Sammy, would you like to ask a question of our guest? I feel like I want to include you in any way I can while you have 10 minutes.
Well, I was going to say, if you want to play a game before I go.
You know it's time. Roll the cue.
I think it's rolling. Oh, you're
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game we're going to play.
Whoa, almost lean against that. That is not...
What is everyone doing?
Oh, we're having fun. So this is called Who Tweeted? It is the Twitter game that is sweeping the nation.
Yes.
One computer monitor at a time. So here is how we play.
Love it.
This is Who Tweeted? Tyra, Paris, or Bieber?
Okay. Tyra?
So, Paris.
Paris.
Bieber.
Or Bieber. Okay.
So what I'm going to do is, one at a time, I'm going to read a series of 8 tweets.
Okay.
And at the end of each one, or as soon as you feel like you know which of those 3 people authored that tweet, you ring in just by smacking the table, saying your name, making a noise.
Literally guessing who tweeted.
Okay. You get 3 seconds to tell me who you think wrote that tweet.
Now, what happens when you get the answer correct, Sammy?
Oh, you ring in, you get it right, you're going to get yourself 5 points.
5 points?
But you ring in, you get it wrong, you're going to lose 3.
Oh.
That's right.
There's a penalty for being wrong.
Do I have to do the math?
No. I will do the math for you.
Okay, good.
No math necessary.
And here's the best part.
We've got Jews. You don't have to do math.
We're not playing for glory.
We're not?
No.
Are we playing against each other?
Well, hell yes we are.
Okay, all right. Wow.
This is not some children's basketball game.
Personal pop quiz, no.
Okay.
It's you and me.
Wow.
To the death. Okay. Or...
$20.
$20.
Fantastic, but you're going down.
Yeah, yeah.
Ooh.
I feel the challenge and I appreciate it. All right.
All right, are we ready?
Can I ask Jamie for, she be my phone a friend?
Yes.
Okay.
It's never been done before, and I think it's time to
but
start.
But I collect
Yeah, she knows.
Okay, there's only one problem.
Yeah. All right, then you're dead to me.
There's only one problem. She has the exact answer.
Yeah.
Okay. I know. Okay.
You've chosen the perfect friend, by the way.
Okay. I'll allow you one Ask the Audience.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I love it. A special live edition, one Ask the Audience.
Here we go. Who tweeted question? Tweet number one.
Look, I'm like fake buzzer.
Funny how I meet people every day. Great people. Smile, take pics, sign things, and then some just like to tell rumors. Hashtag can't win them all. Rachel?
Paris Hilton?
Oh! I'm sorry, no.
Okay.
Bieber?
Bieber.
Oh! No, the game's not easy. If the game were easy,
wouldn't be worth playing.
All right.
Wouldn't be worth playing.
Tweet. So you've dug a little hole, -3 points.
It's all right. It's all right.
How I roll.
Don't worry about it.
How I roll.
Don't worry about it. Okay. Tweet number 2. You ever look at a sunset and go, damn, I'm humbled by such stupendous, glorious
beauty. Kevin Tyra.
That is correct. Darn.
Wait. So it's Bieber, Paris.
Tyra.
Tyra Banks. Okay.
You know, like Elvis, Tyra.
Tyra. God, you guys are okay.
Tweet number 3. Just had a quick snack with a legend. So proud of her.
Ding, ding, ding.
Do you want to ask the audience, or do you got it?
Yeah, no, I'm gonna ask the audience on this one.
Bieber.
They're worth it.
They're horrible. Boo!
Read the tweet one more time.
Just had a quick snack with a legend. So proud of her.
Tyra.
I'm going to say Tyra.
That is correct. Yay! Nicely done. Nicely
they
done.
Came through for you.
I heard female voices screaming Tyra. Yes, thank you very much.
All right.
Fun game, though, isn't it?
It's getting exciting.
You can go to the website and play it, actually.
All right. Now we don't need you to shout out anything ever again. Thank you. Tweet number 4.
There's money involved. You understand.
Another late night working in the studio. What a great night.
Kevin Bieber.
Incorrect.
Yeah!
Let's not forget, Paris Hilton also believes she is something of a singer.
So it's tied now at negative plus two.
Positive two, that is
correct. Hey, I like it though. Yeah,
you're good. She put together very hard.
It's good. It's really good.
We're tied up at positive two.
Tied up.
Okay.
All right.
Tied up. Very exciting. Tweet number five. Nothing better than a good laugh.
These are three of the funniest people on the planet. Kevin Paris.
That is incorrect.
Ah.
Justin Bieber.
Of course. He's hilarious.
He's Canadian. That's all they have.
All right. All right. So you are now...
I'm negative.
He's negative one to your positive two.
So happy. Plus two, negative one.
Tweet number six. We are a family. Never forget that. This thing we have done, this history we are making together, we make together.
Okay, ding, ding, ding. I'm gonna say Paris.
Bieber.
Uh-oh.
Kevin Bieber.
Fortunately, it is Justin Bieber.
Can you read that? Can you read that wildly self-involved, pretentious tweet again?
Absolutely. And this is in bold, by the way. We are a family.
Oh my God.
Never forget that. This thing we have done, this history we are making together, we make together.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's
is
prophetic.
Is talking about the show? Like
he just became the Dane Cook of Twitter.
Well.
What Dane Cook was to MySpace, this kid has now.
I have some good news and some bad news. The bad news is we're now officially in the negative points, but the good news is we're tied at negative one.
Yeah!
Fantastic. So proud.
The penultimate tweet, tweet number seven. The nap that won't go away. How I feel right now.
Kevin Paris.
Oh, sorry, no. Ms. Tyra Banks.
Ms. I was going to say Paris, so I would have done it wrong too.
We're so good at this.
So good.
Still anyone's game.
So good.
Negative four to negative one?
That is correct, sir.
Got so it. I'm winning even though I'm losing.
The eighth and final tweet.
Oh, it is palatable.
You're not wrong.
Unless, of course, there's a tie. I can't find my BlackBerry. So if you texted me and I'm not writing you back, I'm not ignoring you, just don't have it. Smiley face, hashtag brutal.
Ding, ding, ding. I'm going to say Paris Hilton. It's not Paris.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner!
Yeah!
Who tweeted? Miss Rachael.
I'm not taking that.
You have to.
It's a prize. It's a prize.
And parking.
Very, very
nicely
done.
Sweet 20. It's a 20. Will you verify?
Thank you, Sammy.
My absolute pleasure, and I hate to say it, but I gotta go.
You gotta go.
Thanks, Sammy.
Sam Levine, ladies and Jews.
Have
Sammy, take off your fucking microphone.
I don't want to stay on here any longer.
Oh. So much to say.
Thank you so much, buddy. Get over there safe. Be careful.
Have fun.
Don't forget to use transportation of some kind. He likes to run.
Does he? He's like the Flintstones.
Yes, and Doug Benson's nickname, of course, Little Wolverine. Little Wolverine. How sweet. You know what? The hell with him. Let's get back to you.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I'm literally putting this in my back pocket.
Please. Well, you have to. It's
parking.
We're
going to drink at Cobb's later.
Right?
Yep. Or Punchline.
Let's jump around here. Opposite.
Okay.
One of our favorites, RDJ, otherwise known as Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah.
In The Soloist.
Yep.
I'm guessing not too dissimilar than working with Merv Griffin on Fat Actress.
That's good. Robert Downey Jr. was great. He was so funny. I remember we were shooting downtown in Los Angeles at the real Los Angeles Times building.
Right.
Because The Soloist, Robert Downey Jr. plays a reporter that's following Jamie Foxx. Who is a schizophrenic and like a genius violinist, and we were other reporters in the office with him, and we're driving around and we're going from set to set. We're in the car with he, and as we're downtown, a bus with Southern California Correctional Services drives by with prisoners, you know, like people in jail. And Robert is sitting there and he just goes, "Yep, been there." And that's all I can say is I love him.
Yeah.
He's so honest and real. And we didn't spend, I don't want to, you know, we didn't spend a great deal of time together, but
sure.
When we did, he was very sweet and very fun. And I got to work with Catherine Keener and Stephen Root, who to this day is one of my dearest
friends. One of our favorite guests on the show was Stephen Root.
Yeah, he's just so lovely. And so
crazy
that was
talent.
Great. But then Merv Griffin and Kirstie Alley working on Fat Actress was. Merv Griffin, that was such a thrill for me because
sure.
I grew up watching him.
Yeah.
And he was lovely, and he'd be like, "Oh, you have a beautiful voice. Do you sing?"
And
to which I said yes, but I gave it up.
And you sang, like for Chris, you sang the school song.
Yes. I didn't. But it was great because, like, he played the piano and sang while we were shooting, and he was lovely. And so yeah. I'm very grateful that I got to meet him before he passed. He's an icon. You know, he's such a great
guy. Completely and utterly. And it was great to comedians, too, and new to town. Before you got on Carson, you had a shot at getting on Merv.
I thought he was an amazing host.
It was incredibly important. I did, too. He was quite the interviewer, because he seemed so genuinely interested
and
gave a shit.
Well, like Carson, like yourself, you know, very interested and
right, as opposed
engaging.
To, so, not important.
Can't do it.
Can't do it. Why go there?
Ooh, Letterman. We were going to talk about Letterman.
We've got to talk about Letterman, though.
But talk about whatever you want. But
No, let's go to Letterman.
No, that experience, it was my first talk show ever. I got a call on a Wednesday at like 5 o'clock. I was on a television series, and they said they want you to do the show the next day, so I took a red eye.
Oh, God.
Nobody was there. I was in that green room by myself.
Oh, God.
We had a great telephone interview. Like, they always interview you before you go on a talk show and do like a panel. Every talk show is different. I did not know this at the time, but the producer came up to me after our telephone interview, and she said, "This is exactly what you're going to say." And I was like, I'm not a stand-up. I need time to memorize these lines or something. I had no one to call to like say, but the one thing Cheryl Hines had said to me, and I'm going to say it, I don't care. She said to me, "When you sit down on that couch and you look at David Letterman, don't be shocked or surprised by how old he looks." And I remember sitting down, they call, and it's freezing. Like,
yes.
Everybody talks about how cold it is, but really, when you're like, it's fucking cold.
You still can't believe
like,
how cold it actually is.
It's so cold, and so you sit down, and I'm looking at him, and it's like, I leave my body, everything slows down, I'm in super slow motion, and it's like, in my head, there's clapping, it's a nightmare. And he's kind of smiling at me, and I'm thinking, I'm on David Letterman. And I was going, and he does look older than I thought. And then he asks me a question, I start to go, it's like that thing when you don't really know your lines, and you're headed in that direction, and then the wheels totally come off, and you don't know where you are. And you're like, I'm sitting here talking to David Letterman on national television, and every thought has left my brain.
Yeah.
And
well, the pre-interview is the worst thing ever, which is one of the reasons we decided from the beginning that that would never happen on the show. We would do the research, we'd be as prepared as possible, because the pre-interview as a guest means you're basically auditioning your anecdotes with the producer on the phone the night before. So what do you got? What's happened recently? You been on any family trips? They want to know, they try to set you up.
Right.
And then you end up telling them. And it's not supposed to be scripted,
right.
But the host, after a while of doing those talk shows, the host wants, give me these cards, I go, well, you give me some topics.
Right.
Because most of them are in a panic to have an actual conversation.
Yeah.
So they don't want just bullet points, they want taglines, they want out, buttons, punchlines, they want everything.
Yeah.
And for the guest,
it
this
just
is
felt
a
like
nightmare.
It felt like this incredible pressure to perform something that I had never rehearsed.
Right.
That and I didn't know, but it actually, if you see it back, it went very well, and he was very charming when I lost my train of thought, and he was like, "Yeah."
No, he's masterful.
He was very, very sweet, and I remember I came off thinking, I did an amazing job. I was like, this is incredible. I did so great, and I went upstairs and I went up to the green room, and the producer at the time, she walks in, and I said, "Hey," and she and I go, "How about that?" And she goes, "Yeah." She goes, "You didn't pay off that first bit." And it was such...
It took a year to forget that.
I'm still thinking about
yeah.
it. It really rattled my cage. And
Can you imagine?
Well, and now as I'm older, I think back, why would somebody do that to like a sweet person that's like just wants to...
Hates her life, knows Letterman's going to yell at her about it, and
yeah.
decides her only position of power is to give you shit.
Thank you. So, that was better than like the years of therapy that I... No, but it really was...
That's $275.
But I'll happily pay it. I don't care. It's worth it. But when I went on Jimmy Fallon, it was interesting because Jimmy, they kind of did a pre-interview, but not really. And he said, you know, the kids on SNL that would go on Letterman would flip out, like the new kids, because they felt this incredible... So Jimmy had said, no, we're not going to do that,
right.
where I'm going to come on and talk to people. And it, like, this has been lovely because it feels like I'm just talking to you, but I, you know, you get nervous. I'm a nervous performer.
You did not pay that off. That's so weird. Thank you for that, for all of that.
Yeah, you're very, so sweet.
Let's talk, finally, about natural selection. Is there a chance for people to discover it still? Okay, so it's out there. Please find it.
Well, it's crazy because we have the, thank you for mentioning earlier, mm-hmm. the nomination for the film. Well, the film was nominated for Best First Feature for our director, Robbie Pickering, and the whole crew. And then I was nominated for Best Actress in a feature.
Spirit Award. This is a huge, 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 huge big deal. I mean, literally, in the award world,
yeah.
It has become Academy Award, Golden Globe, Independent Spirit Award, above the SAG Award. I really believe that in terms of hype and perception illusion, which is all the show business is anyways, the excitement that an artist feels getting an Independent Spirit Award rises above, because Golden Globe is just, oh my God, it's a great party. The award is complete and utter horseshit. There's 39 voting members, or 79, whatever it is, it's absurd.
I've never been to the actual show, I've just gone to the parties
right,
afterward.
Yeah.
So,
but the Independent Spirit Award is, that's the street cred of award shows other than the Oscars that actually means, I mean, the SAG Award obviously means a big deal, but congratulations.
Thank you. Getting that call really did move me beyond.
Where were you? What happened?
I was, this is so dumb. I was in my house, I just gotten out of the shower, literally in a towel.
Wait, give me a moment.
and I get this call, and they said, we just want you to know you were nominated for an Independent Spirit Award. And I said, shut the fuck up.
Yes!
And then
reaction!
And then I said, I love you.
Right.
To the person that told me. I said, oh my God, I love you. I love you so much. Like, that's truly, really what happened. And I said, I can't believe it. And they're like, I know. And I said, because our film hasn't been released yet.
Oh.
So it qualified for the Independent Spirit Awards because it was at the Los Angeles Film Festival and at South by Southwest.
South by Southwest.
And Lauren Ambrose has the same thing too. She's nominated for Best Actress, and her film comes out later this year too. So Natural Selection will be in New York at the Angelica, March 19th, I think, whatever Friday it is, and then in Los Angeles in May. So it's really exciting that we have a little bit of this going on. Oh, did something happen?
There's some technical difficulties. Otherwise, you wouldn't be up here.
You know what? It's not a party until there's technical difficulties, right?
It's getting a little static.
A little static on the sound? Are we better? We're fixing still? How are we doing? Anybody like it, hate it? Worse, better? Talk to us?
We're still working on it.
Still working on it, okay. Should we, is it my mic? The battery's dead or something?
Oh, is it me?
Ooh. Right?
Good morning!
Let us know when we should jump to the others.
You know, it's interesting, you're on the left side.
Is it possible that my mic was just rubbing into my shirt? No, it's popping. No one's moving, and yet that's happening.
Sam, where's Sam?
It's Sam, that where's fucker Sam's still has his mic on. He's running to the other thing.
Double M like Sam.
What a dick. Better, worse? Make the jump? Hyperspace?
I love all the
right?
I'm going to give you Sam's old mic.
Of course, because it was working great. It's my mic, though, yeah?
Yeah.
So her mic was fine?
Yeah.
Well, she was telling a story. Turn my mic off.
Where was I?
Yeah. Let's go. So you got the phone call. I love you. I love you. Oh, my God. I love you. The film's coming out, Angelica, in March.
In March. And then
San Francisco, LA. Look for the big cities.
Yeah.
But South by Southwest, you are... This is a huge coming out party for
that
the thing.
That was crazy. We did not expect that at all.
Every single award was crazy. It won audience jury awards, best film, best screenplay, best editing, best score. You received Breakthrough Performance Award, as does your co-star.
Right there. Matt O'Leary. He's amazing.
That's extraordinary. I mean, this is just last year, 2011, South by Southwest, which itself has become wildly legitimate and coveted.
Yeah, I feel like South by Southwest is kind of now sort of what Sundance used to be. Yeah,
absolutely.
Because Sundance is more
corporate.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, thank God we got into Sundance. Thank God we got into South by Southwest and didn't get into Sundance. And I say that only because there's so many big films that go to Sundance now that our film would never have stood out.
Right.
Our first screening, we didn't know how many people would be there. We thought maybe it could be 10, it could be 250. Like, we had no idea. So it was really, but I knew we had a really good film.
Yeah.
I felt really good about it. But then, you know, when you shoot films, you have a great experience on set, and then it can turn really, it can be awful after the editing process.
Well, there's 9 million ways to die for sure.
Yeah.
And you don't do any of this for awards, so when they happen, it's surreal, exciting beyond everything, which is why you're saying to a total stranger on the phone, I love you, I love you.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, it wasn't a total stranger.
Good.
In fairness, it was my publicist.
Perfect.
And she's not, and they're really nice, and I do know them really well.
Okay,
so
good.
It's not like they're like, you know, they're people that have worked
someone
with
you
me
care
for
about.
A while.
Yeah. Okay, good.
But the best was telling Peter Principato, my manager, who just was like, my big brother, just like so moved and excited.
What was his response?
He was just like, I knew. He said, of course. He goes, I feel like everybody's just finally arrived to the party.
Right.
Which is very sweet to have your people.
The first-time writer-director, Robbie Pickering, wrote this screenplay, which ended up on Hollywood's blacklist of screenplays. This is an annual tradition now. I'm not sure how long ago it started. But to get on this blacklist means you've actually written a script that's too good, and everyone's afraid to make it, everyone at the studio level. But all the studios and all the agencies become aware of it when it gets on this blacklist,
right,
which is, you talk about street cred, it's absurd what it actually means just to get an unproducible script onto the blacklist.
Right.
So his own story of how he got funding and all of that is one thing, but when it comes to casting, mm-hmm, in such a crucial role as yours, the
right,
female lead, you were suggesting he was not of mind, knowing you from comedy, knowing you from playing a specific riff.
Right.
Is my understanding.
Right. Yeah. No. He said categorically. Is that the right? You said that word.
Sure.
To the casting directors, they said we want you to have a meeting with Rachel Harris, and he said, absolutely not. He's like, she's so beyond wrong for this. I don't want to see her. And they said, well, you need to meet with these people, because if the people, like, if you're top three women that you want to do this fall out, we don't have the budget. You know, it's such a low budget. So
no budget.
There was no budget. We made it for like under $125,000. And if you see it, it's,
if I may, if I may punch up the story a little, when you get to that point,
yes,
we made it for under $125.
Okay, good.
Yeah. $125,000 is still a real wonderful
I know,
low number.
It's like you can buy a house.
But $125.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. No, you're right. That's funnier.
I'm here to help.
Yeah. No, I gotta take what's funnier. Yeah.
But so he's got no money, and
he's got a
list of a wish list of actresses,
right,
who are at the top, and all the
right,
studios want them. The chances of him getting them are ridiculous.
Right.
And so his casting agent is wise enough and wonderful enough to say, here's a list of real talent you need to meet with. But his problem was, he knew you comedically.
Right.
He knew you. This is a very dramatic part.
Yeah. Well,
he couldn't wrap his brain around it.
There's parts that are dramatic, and there's also parts that are very comedic. So
from reality as opposed to jokey, funny.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah, it's very real. That's the, yeah. And that's my favorite out of extreme pain, coming right. to comedy. But so we had this meeting, and I had been through. I mean, why wouldn't the studios want to make it? It's a coming of age story about a 40-year-old woman. Like, who doesn't want to make that in the right. studio system? I mean, that's crazy.
Whose husband is dying? And
whose husband
sends
is
her
dying?
And
he, well, he's dying, and they haven't had sex in 25 years
I'll
because
say.
She's barren, and for whatever reason, and he believes because of their religious beliefs. It, like they grew up in a, it's a very small cloistered Texas town. Very religious, and they believe if you can't produce offspring, it is a sin. It's a sin to do the deed.
Sure.
You know, to like do the act. So for 25 years, they haven't had sex, and then her husband has a stroke. She thinks he's dying. She goes to see him in the hospital. He doesn't have his wedding ring on, and they say she's like, "Where's his wedding ring?" And they're like, "He left it at the clinic." Cut to her at a sperm donor clinic, and he's been donating sperm for the past 25 years. Unbeknownst to her. And of course, like all women, she thinks it's her fault because she was, you know, inadequate. And so, so she sets out on this journey because she feels like obviously he wants to have some kind of a legacy. So she sets out on a journey to find one of the kids that he fathered. And she finds Raymond, this 23-year-old kid.
And it's the journey.
And she brings him back. And it's that, yeah, it's like a, you know, it's the journey to bringing him back.
Yeah. Basically, it's the Shaggy Dog. You never seen that?
It's really close.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just gave you the like what the story was about. Did you even ask me that?
Yes. Know. No. I mean, that's the thing. It's an underdog in every step. So getting on the blacklist, first of all, could have been technically the most successful aspect of the story.
Yeah.
Was that it got onto that list.
It took Robbie like 6 years to get it made.
Yeah. And so from the meeting where he needed this character who is going through this horrible thing, you were going through something horrible in your life and allowed you to be so real in the meeting that you freaked him out and changed his mind.
Yeah.
Is
yeah,
what the,
you
had is it what the research
you really
says.
Heard it. Yes.
Is that?
I was going through, I'd gone through a divorce.
Yeah.
That
always
was
fun.
So much fun. Highly recommend it. No, I always say now. From now on, I say to people though, don't get divorced. I don't care what you do. Try to. I was a big instigator of my divorce, and it's one of the most painful things that I've ever been through. And the being with somebody that you care about for so long, and then going home to that house and. It's literally, you know, they've sort of gutted it from their things.
Sure.
And
that part of you has been cut out.
Yeah. And it's the most haunting experience for me. And I did that with many friends, lots of support. It wasn't a snap decision. And it still rocked me. And so we were
brought all of that into this room.
Yes.
Which is so
bold, attractive.
But it's unbelievably. honest and pure and real.
Yeah, and I was telling him how there's one scene in the movie where she gets home from being at the hospital, she's realizing her husband's gonna die and she starts brushing her teeth. And it's a dual sink, you know, like, and they show scenes of them brushing their teeth together and she's brushing her teeth and it feels, there's no dialogue or anything, but it's just that feeling where you're so uncomfortable.
Utter alone.
Yeah. And she has to turn on the water.
On the other sink.
On the other sink to just feel normal. And when I was telling him that, I just was very I can really relate to that scene.
Right.
Yeah, and then just, you know, questioning and doubting if you've made the right decisions and all that stuff. So I think my producer had said that he got a call 5 minutes after our meeting. And he was like, I was wrong. I think she might be really right for this, but I don't know if she can handle the dramatic aspects of it. So I had to read for him, and I was happy to read because I was like, "Of course, you know, you've never seen me do this." And
right, but so brave, honestly.
Ah,
I mean,
very sweet.
You know, every part of you is protecting yourself in your real life, and then to bring it into that room and sit down with this talent and answer the question, "Why do you think you can do this?" in such a way. That's unbelievably rare, and thank goodness the fruits of your labor are coming through gigantically.
Yeah,
and for you on the set, to be able to do that kind of drama at times. How freeing and wonderful for someone who wanted to do drama so many years before, now right. getting a chance to.
Right. It was amazing. It was so, it was great. And I think also what was great about Kevin was that there was no pressure, like, because it was a small independent feature.
Right.
We had no money. We just had, Robbie's extremely passionate and very supportive. And our producers, everybody was like, we've got this great thing.
Yeah.
We love it. And there was no studio saying, we don't like what she's wearing in this.
Yes. You do get abject freedom for $125,000.
Yes. Yeah. You do. And it was really, we were like in a little, we shot it in Smithville, Texas, and we all stayed at this bed and breakfast. Like, the crew stayed like at a fucking frat house.
Right.
They would just get wasted every night, which was great. They needed to, because they were getting like $100
a day.
Coffee
and donuts, yeah.
Yeah, and no food. But they were always so supportive. And like, I love that. We had Katrina trailers, which means they weren't working. There was no plumbing. So it was just a place for us to change. And then we'd like, you know.
Go to the restaurant to use the
right.
restroom. Like,
right, or we'd stop at like the 7-Eleven or like in that small town, we'd knock on, you know, like people, not knock on doors, but I mean like stop at gas stations.
We're shooting a movie.
Do you mind if I take a dump?
Yeah. How's your shitter?
It's real. But it literally
is. There a door on it? Just answer the question.
Where are you going?
Yeah. Well, you know, the important part of all that is, you know, look what came of this. Look what's happening now. The street cred I was trying to attach to the Independent Spirit Award was driving to this sort of point of, it still exists, the independent filmmaking world. You know, you can actually shoot a movie that is with the right story and the right players for $125,000 all in, becomes nominated alongside of $15, $20 million independent yeah. films. That's extraordinary. That's an accomplishment for the filmmaker for this first time. But you as a performer, to be a part of it, it doesn't normally go this well. Usually you do that passion thing, you learn from it, you have that experience, you have that opportunity, you got to be dramatic.
Yeah.
That's the reward.
Yeah, and you think, oh, well, at least I have something to show people. Like, my agents can send this to...
Bottom line, that's fantastic.
Jenny Larry Johnson.
Yes.
And they'll see me for Law and Order or right. something, you know. And but yeah, so that, it's really, it was highly unexpected and... Yeah, it does. It's everything. You know, yeah. like it's really great.
We're going to be pulling for you, huge. The Independent Aww. Spirit Awards are in
February 25th.
Right.
They're the day before the Oscars.
Right.
They're at the beach. They brought them. Yeah, it's at the beach in Santa Monica.
Right.
It's on the beach. No. I mean, it is, but we're in tents and there's lights and cameras and things like that.
I actually hosted the awards about 10 years ago.
You did.
Yeah.
I hosted a pre-show like 4 years ago.
I remember hosting 10 years ago. John Waters did it for many years. He was the guy. They wanted to mix it up. And I remember hosting and it was so intimidating because it was almost more important than all the cheese and all the fluster of your average award show. It was like, wow, this thing really means something. Speaking of which, means something, mm-hmm. I insist on involving our audience. We're just about out of time, but I did want to offer up a few questions, if you don't mind.
I do not mind.
Ask Rachael. This is from @bpendy. Any questions through Twitter if you ever want to join the live show, folks, or the Facebook. We take them from there as well. @bpendy asks Rachael about her 21 accents. You did this video for okay. Funny or Die.
Okay. Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No, that was, I was, I have to give credit to my ex-husband because there was a thing on YouTube called Amy Walker Does 21 Accents. And she does, if you look it up on YouTube, it's amazing. This
sure.
woman actually does 21 accents in about 2 minutes.
So why not mock her?
And yes. But there was something in her eyes that made me go...
Bachman? Little Bachman?
Yes. That I was like, I got to do it. I got to do it. And it was like, what if I tried to do 21 accents? Me, just like me trying to do it. And it just goes off the rails. And so, but it was with Funny or Die. And this was back in the day when Funny or Die was just starting. And I was telling you, like, we went to the 101 Cafe. And we'd be like, eh, let's just try this. What do you think? If not thinking, this is going to be in on the internet forever.
Yeah.
Like, people will see this forever.
This is in their library.
I will never be able to erase it.
Yeah.
So there was no fear. It felt like a Groundling sketch where I could just get up and try it. And if it didn't work, oh, well.
Yeah.
It was fun. But that was literally, like, I would try to do 21 accents, and I end up screaming at the person who's filming, and, like, what number are we on? And they're like, 7, and I'm like, fuck you. Because I'm so...
Go to Funny or Die and check that out, please.
And I love Funny or Die. They've been very good to me, too.
Yeah, it's so a nice. Lot of fun over there. At Jorgen E. Peterson, mm-hmm. a great scribe, he's written some amazing material that I've read, actually.
Oh.
He's got a question for it. What was it like entering the mythology of Star Trek Voyager by playing one of the main characters' mothers, Kes?
It was amazing. Like, I
that is the correct answer, by the way.
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, my brother, Bruce, was a big Star Trek fan when we were growing up, so I felt super cool that I was getting do that. But the best thing was is that I got to be in El Campo, so they had put prosthetic ears on, so that was cool because I felt a little bit like Spock.
Sure.
And, like, I got to wear ears like that, and then I had to. I'm in this scene. I'm giving birth to Kes, but El Campos give birth out their back.
I'll say.
So you're literally pushing on a birthing bar, and it literally looks like I'm taking a shit. Like I'm. That's not ladylike.
No.
That I said shit though, but it literally looks like I'm taking I'm pushing the baby out. You can see it. It's on YouTube. It's on.
Oh my God.
It's really important.
And no. Why didn't you just show the Robbie that?
I know. I should have. And Robbie, yeah. If I had shown him that, he would have never.
This is
ever
why
dated
I don't
me.
Want her.
Yeah.
Yeah, he would have said. All right, another thing we have for the fans, they can write in a thing on the show. We have another cue for this, thanks to Dave Koechner, who we just love.
Oh, Dave Koechner so much.
Yeah, it's called Tweet 5.
T5 forever now.
That's beautiful.
The visual of that on, oh, you're going to love it.
It's beautiful.
What I hate about that is you can hear me, or maybe it's just me, guffaw.
In the background?
I want to hear it again.
Play one more time if you can.
Like, you hear it right at the beginning, you hear me go,
T5 forever now.
Because he's making the goofiest face on the planet when he did it.
How can you not look at him and not laugh?
Okay, these are rapid-fire Coke or Pepsi, no correct answer questions specifically designed for you by the fan. This one from at Professor _D. Broccoli or peas?
Broccoli.
Oak or hickory?
Okra.
Beer or wine?
Wine.
Carry on, check bag?
Check it.
Grandmaster Flash, Run-DMC?
Run-DMC.
All correct.
Can I say one thing, though?
Please.
If it was a beer or wine, I should have said neither.
Nice.
My drink is tequila.
Hello.
Which makes me sound like a horrible booze bag.
We're all horrible booze bags here.
But I'm not.
Margaritas are delicious.
And listen, I don't even do it margarita style. They are delicious.
They are delicious.
But the sugar is what gives you the hangover, people. Mm. So what you have to do is you have to get clear tequila. You put it over ice.
Hello.
A little bit of lime, maybe a little agave, and then you sip it. And it's happy times. you don't shoot it. Like, what? Shoot? What? Like, shoot it up? I don't know what I'm doing.
Well,
like,
earlier you said sniff cocaine, and I let that go.
What do you do?
Snort. You snort.
You snorted.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You sniffed it, though.
Why didn't you call me out on that?
It was too beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I get that stuff wrong all the time. That's my thing. I'm always getting that stuff wrong.
Yeah. Shooting the heroin, not injecting.
Right.
All right. Listen, I warned you at the top about the Larry King game.
Oh, God.
Let me reiterate. It's a bad Larry King impression.
Okay, bad Larry
King. No pressure for a good one.
Okay.
Larry sharing something about himself on the air that we really didn't need to know.
Oh,
right,
God.
Before he goes to the phones.
Right.
You know, he'll share something
right.
and then go to the phone. And right. if the name of the city is funny sounding, maybe a city near where you grew up,
uh-huh.
that sounds funny to you.
Yes.
These are the only rules. Your cameras, that one right there, if you can see it through the lights, they're a little bright.
Okay.
But the larger one here, I believe, is your camera that you'll be doing it.
It's time to play the Larry King game on Kevin Pollak's chat show.
Horrible eczema. Eczema on my elbows. Parma, Ohio.
Yes.
Go.
Yes.
And that's how you play the Larry King game.
That was really bad.
You know what? That's perfect, Larry. Are you kidding? Listen, it should not.
Is that what it is? Like he shares like.
Yes.
He always says things like. But I didn't want to say, like, my balls itch.
Thank you for that. Thank you. You did not go to Easy Town.
Yeah.
You earned it.
Eczema is always funny.
Yeah, please. When is it not? I can't thank you enough. Mm. I greatly look forward to continued and massive success for you.
Thanks.
Let's hear it, please, for our guest, Rachael Lee Harris.
Thank you. Yeah, my pleasure.
Sit there uncomfortably for 90 seconds while okay. I wrap things up for the folks at home. Jamie?
Yes, I'm.
Had enough?
I need a drink.
Yeah. thank you all.
Possibly a sandwich.
Possibly a sandwich, yeah, there's some food involved. Thank you all so much here at the Punchline at Revision 3 again for all their amazing production work. Building the infrastructure for us in a couple of hours was just historically and greatly appreciated. Josh Negert and Dr. Kenny Chen pulling through, flying in day of, flying back out tonight just to pull off this little miracle for the last couple of hours. And thanks greatly to the live audience also and all the staff and crew here at the Punchline. Check our calendar, kevinpollakchacha.com, for upcoming shows. We do have some great ones. We're going to be taking this next Sunday off because someone thinks she may be hungover after her 30th birthday party. I don't know who, but you can hear her voice apparently at the top of the T5, guffawing.
Making that noise I just made right now?
Yeah, there it is. And Sam Levine, of course, who had to dash out because he's so fucking important. but great shows coming up. Please check the calendar there. And thanks, all, obviously, to everyone at Sketchfest for having us for our second annual. Can't wait to come back for the third annual if they'll have us. And it's so weird to not have our personal mugs for the sign-off here. But until next time we meet again, and as always, get out of my face.